Welcome to the Policy Review Committee for December the 4th, 2024. We'd like to acknowledge that we are on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territories of the Inca, Kapmuk, and Sioux people. And so, first order of business we have is to adopt the minutes of the Policy Review Committee meeting dated October the 24th, 2024. We have a seconder? Any questions? All in favor? Okay. Carried. Okay. So we unfinished business, no. And 4.1, we have the Parks Bylaw Policy Review Committee too. Okay. For council consideration. Okay. So I don't know if.
We have discussed
Recording. So this bylaw did come before council in the last session, but or before the committee in the last session, but it was the consolidated versus the draft that you needed to see. So this is where we talked about putting some more conditions on overnight sheltering in Quelccana Park, and that there would be specific area sizes that your tent could be or your shelter could be, and that if you were packing it up and stuff, and some things around no attaching shelters with tarps and things like that. So,
And I noticed in red that we had that no earlier than 7 and removed from the park by 9 because it
yep.
used to be no earlier than 8 p.m. and removed by, I think, 8 a.m.
AM, yeah. And
And specifically to Nicola. So, Art, with this change, will we be implementing any park, or will it be Nicola, or will we even have a park designated? Because that's what I was unclear.
it remains Nicola Park.
Okay.
We just haven't been able to find a better spot yet. And unfortunately, currently nobody's using Nicola Park. Like, there are no shelters in Nicola Park. Yeah, so they our legal counsel recommended, based on current case law, that we extend the time
Okay.
for overnight sheltering. But also that we could put some restrictions on what those shelters look like, how big they are, and when they close them up, when they take them down, that if they're staying in the park for the day without their shelter up, that it had to be it has to also fit within a small size and be tidy. And so
Which makes sense. And then also when it says no parking in the park. So when there's the parking lot, if people are parked there, is that even
no
considered?
overnight
Okay.
camping in the parking lot, overnight use of the parking lot for a campsite.
Okay. Yeah, which makes sense. But if a person, say, was broken down and they happen to be stopped there, that would be
It's an entirely different
different
situation. If you're
situation.
using it
Okay.
to shelter, it's entirely different.
Yeah, so with the park situation where we have, okay, no selling, no removing of soil, no, like that's pretty standard. I mean,
All standard, yeah.
you don't want people vandalizing. Okay, and we have Mayor Mike. Oh, your mic. Oh, okay. And Councillor Charney. There we go.
Okay, on 6.1, the very last sentence, may then immediately dispose of them. We had to store their items before. We don't have to store them anymore. Why don't we just leave them on?
Based on the council, the legal counsel's recommendation, we do not have to store them. It's easier to just say we're going to dispose of them. We have
It
had
says
some, yeah, we may, we don't have to, depends on what it is, but we've had break-ins into our public work yard because people have been trying to get possessions back. So ideally, we're not storing them in a manner in which people will then be breaking into our facilities and causing damage that we have to pay for.
yeah, that was the only question I had, and then I have two housekeeping
Oh, good.
items.
Okay.
So on 4.8, no person shall throw or place on the ground, not grounded.
Okay, she got it. Good, she got it.
Okay. And 6.2, the city, comma, may recover as a debt, comma, its costs and expenses. Nitpicky, but that's the way it is. Okay, so that's all I had on that one.
Good luck.
Oh, we're not on to this next
no,
section.
No, we're just
so okay, that's I right. guess we have to vote. Also review, direct staff to bring forward to council consideration. And I seem happy with that. So
yep. Yeah, well, I would just say if there's still housekeeping on 6.2, the official should be
So vehicles may be capitalized because it's could be a definition, and it's some of our bylaws definitions are capitalized. We're trying to consistently.
Like, would be greater than.
Depends if it's a definition or not.
No.
Yeah, there may not be a definition for trailers in the bylaw. It's in the definition section. There's a whole section of that has the definitions.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, okay. So,
actually, I've got a comment.
Go ahead.
So, I don't want Nepal Park to be the park of camping any longer.
I don't either.
I don't want to have camping in the city at all. Until the province decides what a temporary shelter looks like. I don't want, it brings nothing but problems. With the Ron Carlson shooting, I think it was very obvious what happens with these. The thing that bothers me is the fact that we have these rules and then they've got to be out by a certain amount of time. They tell you to go screw yourself and then they do whatever they want. So those days are done. I'm not supporting any of this. I don't want camping anywhere. I don't care what the legal opinion is. Let the province take us to court on it, because at some point in time, we have to have a situation where we cannot have non-taxpayers telling everybody in the city and the taxpayers what they're doing. So Nicola Park, I want out, and we'll find another spot if we have to, but the province has to come to the table and let us know what they're willing to do. The downloading on this has to stop, and the fear that comes to the community and the paralyzation that comes to the community on this has to stop as well. So I do not want any camping within city limits at any point in time until the province comes up with a plan on how that's going to look like.
So you're saying eliminate 0.5s and...
Eliminate the whole damn thing.
Yeah.
Everything.
Okay.
I would go for that.
The point of the matter is, is let the province now tell us, and I know, staff, you're going to get legal
opinions. I'm going to give you the legal opinion.
And I get
that,
but at some point, there comes a pushback on this, and I think we need to push back and say, okay, that's fine. I've been very vocal with the fact that there's enough crown land around that we could possibly start to do something where we could put them on crown land and we could build a permanent situation with the money that they've given to the shelter, that we could actually have a forever home situation built rather than a temporary 2-year. This is a band-aid solution. And it doesn't help anybody. It doesn't help anybody at all. And the thing is that we cannot control what happens in those tents. Now, the shelter, we know that everybody is registered. We know that everybody, what we're trying to do with the shelter is we're trying to have locals involved with that as well. So if locals first and then out of province. And of course, we all know right now what out of province means because they're here because of the 2.5 decrypt, which the police chiefs have now pulled their support on, by the way, 2 days ago. They've all pulled their support on that. So I see the 2.5 decrypt, and that's why I wrote, I've made it clear that without the ministry, which is no longer involved, how do you have a pilot program that's being led by nobody? Mm-hmm. So it's got to be gone. So hopefully the police chiefs will pull that out. But at this point in time, with the issues that we've had and the phone calls that I have to field constantly over this from taxpayers who do pay a tax, and these folks do not care one little bit about how we maneuver, what we do, or how we think. So at this point, I would like us to kill this whole thing off, but that's just me.
I would,
Councilor Charney.
I would definitely support, because that was one of my things. I said, "Why Nicola Park?" And I'll even go the step further. I agree. I think it brings our town down, and you come down the hill and they're spread out all over, and they don't just stay in Nicola Park. They're on the picnic benches in Lions Park. They're all over, and it's just not pleasant to look at. and the crime they bring. We all know what
and
that
the
is.
Disrespect they show the community.
That's right.
Sports.
Disrespect. So, and I've always said that money, a lot of money is going into people that don't pay taxes. And we as taxpayers have to pay it. And I know this is another download from the government, but somewhere you have to take a stand. And yeah, maybe we get in trouble, but maybe other communities will finally see it too and follow.
So I appreciate everyone's comments because, I mean, who wouldn't agree with those statements? But do we vote to bring this to the next meeting then? I mean,
yeah, being quite patient,
CEO.
I think you, first off, I think you have to vote to bring it to council because I don't think this committee can make a decision to kill a bylaw.
No, that's what we're talking about.
Yeah. But ultimately, you are legally required by case law. So the Supreme Court of British Columbia has identified through case law that you must provide a designated overnight sheltering location. Nicola Park was identified at some point. Is it the right place? No. We simply haven't had the opportunity to advocate to the government about Crown land, although I've thrown it out to a few people, and to find an alternative location. Absolutely, that is a project where is on our books to find an alternative location. You know how many projects we have, so we're working as best we can towards that. But if council chooses to not allow overnight sheltering in a designated location, it's not going to stop people from sheltering everywhere. We already don't have people using it. Nobody will use Nicola Park right now because of the last time we cleaned it, they have reported to their advocates that they felt threatened by us, by the city, that they felt unsafe because of the city's actions. So they're spread out in the community. More than three quarters of the people who are identified as unhoused in our community identify as Merritt residents. Either they're from the valley or they're directly from the community, and have been here for more than, I think it's more than 2 years is the stat.
Yeah.
So, so there are a few things. You will... If council does not permit, I will guarantee you that if council does not permit overnight camping, overnight sheltering in some location within the municipal boundaries, that we will be taken to court.
Can we not say that temporary shelter will be provided, location to be determined?
No, because they have to have a place immediately.
Well, no one's camping outside now.
Lots of people are camping outside, just not in Nicola Park. They're behind some of the local businesses downtown.
Oh.
We have many places where people are sheltering
in cubby holes.
Yeah.
Probably under the bridge.
Yeah. So it is a tough thing because it isn't ideal, but many of these people are not going to leave the community just because we don't provide shelter space.
They're just hidden.
Hidden all over the place. They're bouncing around. Wes, our bylaw officer, is chasing them from location to location, right? We're cleaning up we're cleaning up possessions on a regular basis. We're cleaning up, you know, food that's left, actual garbage that's left in various locations.
Feces.
Yeah. So it's irrelevant. We're going to continue to have overnight camping. Having it in a designated location actually is easier for us to manage, and it's easier for the service providers to do outreach. But there are advocacy groups in this province that will immediately descend upon Merritt if you do not allow this to happen. And we will not, if we lose, if we take this to the Supreme Court and we hire legal counsel and all of that stuff, we will not recoup any of those costs. So if we spend $50,000 on legal counsel, there is no way in which we will recoup any of those costs, whether we win or lose a court case.
Could we end up having to pay the legal fees of the...
No, probably unlikely.
Okay.
Because it's not a fine, or it's like not a civil proceeding.
Okay.
But we will eat those legal fees.
So
and they could cost thousands of dollars.
Go ahead.
No,
I think
that's what I said, Mike. Go ahead.
So let me rephrase that. Let's pull Nicola Park out and use part of the airport.
Okay.
Okay.
Because Nicola Park is not going to work for anyone. Now, we've got the airport lands. We have airport lands that are sitting empty and they're fenced.
Mm-hmm.
So for a temporary, I still, one of my pet peeves this year and one of my jobs this year will be to present to the government getting Crown land, 15 acres, get something built with the money, pallet homes, whatever you want to call them, and get our locals somewhere to start to realize. Because the tiny town in Kelowna is working a bit. They have had some successes and they've had some crashing failures. It's the way it's going to be. You're dealing with a marginalized group of people. But Nicoala Park can no longer be the park of choice. It just simply cannot be. It's not safe. It's not safe for anyone. We have lands up at the airport. Now people are going to say, oh, it's kind of a long way, but a lot of these people are coming from Calgary and Edmonton. So if they can get there from here, they can get up the airport.
And they
So
can get a bus if they want to come to town down to downtown.
I'm
It's not
just
stopping and everything up there.
saying
Well,
that
if they need a doctor,
and
they
you
can
know
get
what?
the
They'll
bus.
just get a bike and
I'm just saying it Nicoala Park, if we have to have a spot, fine. But Nicoala Park is the worst spot we could possibly have. And
I
it's
do.
been shown to be the worst.
So we will make an edit to that to be a lot at the airport. We'll determine with the director of public service, public works, which of the three fence lots he prefers that they be in. Because we do have one that we're going to use for some other things around dealing with some of the stuff that's accumulating on the roadways that we're trying to dispose of. So we'll talk to the director and find out which lot. We'll make that edit into the bylaw. And if that satisfies council, I think it satisfies our legal obligations.
Yep.
Then you can bring that without having to come back here.
Yes.
Bring that to council.
Yeah, that direction.
Okay. So I think we need a vote, though, for it to come back to council. So do
Yeah.
we want to table that, or is it just going to come back to
This should just
council?
come back to council. If council, if ca
Yeah.
this committee is satisfied with the amendment,
Yep.
then we can bring that right to council.
Okay. Well,
Okay, I'll make that motion.
seconder. All in favor? Okay, so next piece of business, fees and charges bylaw that the policy review committee directs staff to bring forward a proposed amendments. Okay, so what do we have here? The fees. The CAO, or did you want to?
Yeah, I will. Thank you. So I provided you with a draft of the briefing note that we would be providing to the whole of council because I felt like it was the fees and charges bylaw is a very big document. It's rather complex in the number of fees that we have. And so as a result, we wanted to make sure that you understood why we formatted it the way we did. So there in the draft briefing note, you will note that the majority of fees are staying pretty stable at that 5% increase year over year, which is what we proposed last year to keep up with the cost of inflation and the cost of doing business. The place where you'll see the most dramatic increases are in water and sewer again. Our preliminary assessments of the cost of water and sewer operations is that we are undercharging just for the operational side. Undercharging about $700,000. And if we're talking about the capital side, that's another six to $800,000 per year. Well, it's more than that, but we're hoping to be somewhere in the right ballpark. So what I've done is ask for an increase that is about 15% for a single family dwelling. And then for dwellings, single family dwellings that have suites, we've given them a percentage, a much more realistic percentage. So if you have a one or two bedroom suite, you're right, you might not be watering the grass, but you're still using water. And so that is now a more consistent number in that it's the cost of a single family dwelling plus 80, 75%. I can't remember what I put in there. And then the cost of an apartment or suite that is separate for some reason, again, is consistently 75% of what a single family dwelling has. Just we've single family dwellings that are only two bedroom and have small lots, right? Same thing with mobile home parks. Each of those mobile homes has been consistently paying less for water and sewer services than a single family dwelling. And ultimately, they are a single family dwelling. Most of them have some sort of lawn. So there's no reason why they couldn't be paying the same amount as a single family dwelling.
So my question then, when you have non-metered water rates, residential, okay,
Yeah.
so you have a single family, so what are they paying now? Because that's what we don't have.
Oh, sorry, you don't have that?
No, because the thing
What?
is
Oh,
that,
you mean what did they pay in our last utility bill?
yeah, the current,
487.68.
No, it's not.
That's what I just paid last time without the
No,
discounts
but
because
that's
there's a
just, this
draft.
is just
And
water.
the oh, water
It
was
does not.
$217.43.
Can you pull it up?
43.
Okay.
Okay, so we'll just pull it up for you.
217.43
Yeah,
for
so
water.
it is, this is again, some pretty significant, the biggest increases come to single family dwellings with suites. That's a bigger proportional increase than a single family dwelling is
Okay,
experiencing.
because right now people with suites are paying more, but how much more? Like, because that's almost 100% increase, like going from 250 to 437. I mean, I understand, like, if you have a 5-bedroom home and 2 bedrooms is a suite, sometimes people have the same house next door and it's the same number of bathrooms. It's just one was put in a legal kitchen to accommodate some people. So, I mean, that's doubling almost.
Well, or, but this is the issue, right? This is why we have to get water meters in because we cannot realistically identify what people should be paying.
Before we jump into these schedules, can we address the stuff at the front of it?
The
Mr. Go.
preamble?
Yes, I got a lot on the preamble here.
Well, the preamble is just the legal.
Yeah, but there's a lot of questions and there's mistakes.
Oh, sorry, on the briefing note?
Yes.
That's just the draft of the briefing note. So the questions on that draft, absolutely. That briefing note should identify specifically to the rates and fees.
Okay, so can we talk about that
Sure.
first?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you want housekeeping first?
No, don't worry about housekeeping. You can give that to me after because it is
Okay.
just the draft that's gonna for
Okay.
what's gonna go to
So on
council.
page 17 of 97, which is page 3 of this, currently properties that do not have active utility counts are not contributing to the operation or capital costs, which is correct. This includes property owners who are not actively, and it should be using, their improved or unimproved parcels for a portion of the year and having the water turned off. This practice has not changed the cost of operations and is one of the reasons that we are seeing the funding gap. So we have a lot of snowbirds. We have people that leave in the summer. They turn the water off. They pay for a disconnection. They pay for a connection. They're not using any water, sewer, or garbage. So why are we considering going to penalize them? They're not the problem.
They in fact are a part of the problem, a part of the problem, because what happens is when we say, okay, the water and sewer system costs us this much money, and because we're not metered and we don't know what people are paying or using or who's using how much, when we shut off a system and they're not paying a share, a portion of the system, when we say, okay, there are 30 or there are 2,800 residences and there are 1,000 businesses, okay. So those 2,800 residences, this is each residence's portion of the cost of water and sewer. And this is each
Whether they use it or
business's
not.
But that's your
portion.
parcel tax.
No,
That's
parcel
but
tax is a different thing. Parcel
okay,
tax is a taxation. This is a user fee.
but you're not using, see, there you got user fee. And if you're not using it, I just really find that hard to penalize people and they're not using it.
So, Wendy, here's the thing. If you have a piece of property in the city and there's no water or sewer or anything to it, you still will be charged for a hookup, whether you're hooked up or not.
Yes, but you're not in charged your
Yes, you are.
water and sewer
Yes, even if you're not hooked up, yes, you will be. That's just the,
quarterly
yep.
right now.
Yep, that's the way it
Well,
is.
that's
Not
that
right
can't
now,
be
not right
not
now,
now,
Merritt. So
not
I
now.
thought that was the deal. So what
Because
rate,
we've had some people
Merritt?
come and said,
Yeah.
I
Yeah.
have a lot, I'm not even hooked up, and I'm getting my parcel taxes.
Yes, your parcel
Okay. Get your
taxes,
parcel tax, but
but
you
your
don't get
water
the
and sewer.
utility.
So your parcel taxes are capital,
Yes.
right? Your
Yes.
water and sewer user fees, that's operational.
But you're
So
not using
the
it, so
cost
how
of
can you?
operations does not change because you're not using water and sewer,
Well,
right?
that's why
If you,
water meters have got
it
to be.
is everybody has a share that they have to pay,
Yep.
or we're underfunded
Okay,
because we
then.
don't know. I
Okay.
could choose to take a
Okay.
year off
I know, but you'd
and
still be responsible for all of that.
yeah.
However, if those snowbirds want to go away,
Then they might as well not even pay to have it shut off or turned off.
No, because I'm going to go back to that saying they come in and I know it takes less than 2 minutes.
To
They
shut it off.
come, they don't even turn the truck off. They get out, shoop, back in the truck. Within 2 minutes, they're gone. And you're charging $100?
And
That's ridiculous.
$100 is
two men in
significant.
a truck.
Well, except
Well,
that if
you know
you're
what, when our public sees that,
it's everywhere, Wendy. It's not just in
I
Merritt.
know,
Yeah. It's standard operating procedure in every community in BC.
but does that mean it's right? Does it
No,
mean
but
it's
we're not going to be
right?
You've got to
And
remember, you've got to remember, you have to be qualified and certified to turn those on and off.
oh my God.
You do.
They have to take, there are many certification courses that our staff have to take in order to do water and
Yeah.
sewer. Yeah.
But what the thing is that if you go do it yourself and something goes wrong, you're gonna
You
be
can
fine.
actually contaminate the entire system.
Well, I'm just, I
You're not wrong, and
strongly
this is
object.
so last spring I had a call from a lady who had just gotten back from Palm Springs. Was very upset that she'd been gone for 3 months and she had a water bill. And I said to her, well, you're paying for everybody else's water. You're bulk paying for water. But if you had water meters, that would fix it. I was never a fan of water meters, but the more that I look at it, the more I think we need water meters for this reason alone. If you're not using, like, I shouldn't have to pay for the same amount of water for somebody who lives 2 doors down that has a gigantic pool, but I
Well,
do.
but I agree with that. And the same thing you could say here. If I'm not using any water, why am I paying the same as
Because
I was paying?
there's no way to meter it.
Because the
Well, sure,
cost
it's the
doesn't
city that
change.
comes in and turns it off, and they know darn well that there's no water, sewer, garbage
But
happening.
the operational cost, the cost of the truck doesn't change. The cost of the staff doesn't change. The
Nope.
cost of the chemicals doesn't change. So the operational cost does not in any way change because snowbirds leave for the winter. There's no change in the cost. We still have to have the same number of staff. We still have to have the same amount of chemicals. We still have to have the same inspections. We still have to have the same planning. Everything still costs the same amount. So if it costs $1 million to run our water system, just our water system, it costs $1 million whether 10 houses shut their water off or they don't. It costs $1 million. There's no changing that. And right now, the system is set up so that 2,800 homes pay us the same portion, and 1,000 businesses pay their equal portion. And that, if you shut off houses or shut off businesses, then you're not getting that revenue. And that's why we have a gap, because we're giving things away for free. And yes, you might not physically be getting water into your house, but the water's still going through the pipe outside your house. But we still have to be able to replace curb stops. We still, like, all of that stuff still exists. Whether you shut the water off for a day or you shut the water off for 6 months, you still have a responsibility in a
Then
civil
don't
society
double
to
whammy him
pay your
then.
proportion.
You're triple whammying them actually,
Well,
because you're charging them for water that's not being used. You're charging them to turn it off. You're charging them to turn it on. And if you add that all up, that's a lot of money for something that's not being used.
but it costs money every single time we send a staff member
No, it
out to do
doesn't. You
that.
know what? I don't go with that, because you know what? Joe Blow is getting his water turned off Friday at 7:30 in the morning. That's in the person's schedule. All you have to do is schedule it. So I don't
But then they're
agree with
not
that.
doing other things,
Oh
right?
yes, but
Because
you know
the
what? Two
idea
minutes.
is, if I provide you with a special service, it costs
But
you, it should cost
that's
you
what
money.
we pay
No,
taxes
it's not.
for.
You pay taxes for the general work that we do. If I come to your house and I provide you a special service, then that is your cost.
Well, then
It would
make
be
it
the same as
appropriate with what the time they're using then.
you're talking about trained individuals using municipal services, using, like, I
See,
look at
so
municipal.
at $100 for, okay, from A to B, it's 15 minutes anywhere in town. So $100 for 15 minutes. So that's $400 an hour that we would be charging. That's what it would be an hourly rate. At $100 for 15 minutes. So that you could say that's
Well,
pretty rich.
I understand the tree you're barking up, but that's the entire country of Canada has the same rules. So
My big comment with
Sorry, can I just maybe can we just turn the counter top turn our things off for a second?
Oh, sure.
That was. One question I have is, what are we currently paying right now for a regular home? So I understand if we're paying 217 to the 250, the 15% seems reasonable, but what is the difference right now for a single family with a suite just on water? Because I know that last year it went from whatever, six something to about 750 for a house with a suite, and that has a lot of utilities. So I'm just wondering what's the effect. Like, I understand that.
It's quite a bit different. I think it's 65%. Yeah, so what I'd say is, this is if.
So what I would propose to you is, if we were to try and close the funding gap in 1 year, this is what it would look like.
Yeah.
If you choose not to close the funding gap in 1 year, you may choose to say we're going to close it over 3 years. So that would be, so right now it's close the funding gap in 2025 and then 5% increases to keep up with the cost of living. So if you say, okay, we want to close the funding gap over 3 years, we don't want to burden so these people more than these people, whatever. But ultimately, people who typically people who have suites use more water than people who don't.
Yes, I understand. My concern is that we had 2024 and 25 with assumed tax increases. And last year, just because nobody was kind of suggesting anything, the suggestion of the 5% was just to get a number out there. Granted, it's both, obviously it's not enough. And if we did 15, I'm just thinking.
So that was the parcel tax was 5%. The
Yeah, the
water and sewer
utility
was 25%,
25, yeah.
which did not
Yeah.
close the funding gap. So you could say, okay, let's close the funding gap over 3 to 4 years.
Well,
We could come back with some different percentages over the next 3 to 4 years.
and I think that would be nice because if we're going up 65% on the services in 1 year, along with the regular increase, I just think it's a lot for the community. And anyway, the
Well,
mayor.
it's gone up from, we did it twice.
Hold on a second, everyone. So I don't know if everybody watched the news this morning. Vancouver is talking a 5 to 7% raise in taxes, but they're talking water 25 to 38% because it's the same thing. They've been caught behind the eight ball. Everybody seems to be falling into this water sewer situation. So, I mean, when you see this, the low end would be 25, the high end would be 36%. So that's what they're talking about down on the coast as well because they are having shortages of making things work. So. And I don't know if this has just been something that Standard has always kind of been put to the back, but other communities are having the same conversation about their water and sewer. And those percentages is what everybody's looking at. And I agree, it doesn't have to all be done in 1 year.
Well,
Fine.
yeah, that's my point
No.
because I.
Better put your mic on.
So from 2024 to 2025, it's an increase of $254.44 for the year. So how is that going to close the gap? And
So,
how much will it close the gap? And does that mean we still have to go another
no.
$250 over the next year?
So, if right now, with what we've got, if the cost of what we do doesn't go up substantially, this amount closes the gap. Now, I presented it to you as a one-time close the gap, but you are more than welcome to say, okay, we're going to close it over 3 years, so we'll spread that increase. Now it'll still need to be cumulative, so it'll still need to be some, that 5% cost of living or 5% inflationary increase as well. So maybe it's you want to do, overall a 20% increase over year. But ultimately, For a single family dwelling, it's like a 15% increase for sorry, where am I on my briefing note here? I think I wrote it in here. For sewer has a much more significant increase because the sewer fund is actually significantly underfunded. So the water account is its own account, the sewer account is its own account, solid waste is its own account, like the garbage collection. And water is close, sewer is really not close, like at all. And so we can look at these and say, okay, instead of doing it all in 1 year, which is going to cost this much, we can do it over 3 years and make it a little bit easier for people to digest. But that does mean 3 years of probably 10 to 15% increases.
I would be tempted to want to go 15% this year just because we're already doing the base tax increase of probably the 10%, and I just it's a lot with the utilities. And I do see Councillor Charney's point with the, you're paying a fee to turn it up. I understand also what you're saying. Services still run, roads are plowed, garbage is picked up. Like we're a town, it runs garbage and sewer, like but also it's the sticker shock all at once. And also the mayor has a point too. Vancouver had an increase, but I thought, well, 15 is still less than 25. And if we do something this year, something next year, it's slow increments. And I think that's where we've been behind the ball, is that if we do small increases, then it's easy, it's more palatable.
Yeah.
It's not as,
So what it means if council decides they want to spread the increase out over 3, 4 years,
or even two.
what it means is that the tax revenue has to be higher because when we are under service, underfunded for water and sewer, that operational money comes out of the tax revenue. So it's like
So it's
this
no
catch.
cost savings.
It's hard to find that cost savings,
It's
right?
just robbing Peter to pay Paul.
Yeah, pretty much. Which is what we were doing with the reserves, right? We were same
So
problem.
you say we have closed the gap some.
We did close the gap some from last year when we did a 25% increase.
Yes.
But it's still
When you
between.
say gap, is it the it's not the reserve, is it?
No, it's what it costs versus
Cost
the
and
revenue for
rate.
user
And so,
fees.
how close are we?
$700,000 just for operational. That's not putting anything additional in the bank for infrastructure. And our parcel tax is we've earmarked all of the parcel tax in sewer just for replacement of the wastewater treatment plant. So that's not going to any other underground infrastructure. So that parcel tax that we collect has to go to just the wastewater treatment plant so that we can find our portion, our 50%, to be able to get any funding, which is what
So,
Councillor Yin mentioned last night.
with this increase, I'll just say $250 a month or a year.
A month, that would be
Yeah,
terrible.
yeah. Will, and I don't know how many residents there are, will that make it so that it's even, or we might have a little bit extra for inflation?
No, we're actually this amount will get us even as long as we continue with inflationary increases year over year. So we can't stop doing inflationary increases. This is like when we talk about zero tax. It's really when you have an inflation, it's really impossible for us to continue to offer the same level of service without some sort of tax increase because everything goes up, right? And the cost of things for a municipality actually goes up. There's an index that's significantly higher than to the general person, like a typical person. So our level of inflation is actually higher than individuals. Sorry, that's a lot of talking. Right?
I have a just a quick question. I know that with the flood situation, zones 3 and 4 had a situation where water turnoffs and turn-ons were comped by the city, and permitting was comped by the city. That's all been removed.
There
Okay.
are a
Well,
couple that we're still working through.
okay.
And so I don't know that there's ever been a resolution from council to end that. We've talked about
We've
it,
talked about
but
it.
I don't think we've had a resolution. So if that's a resolution you'd like us to include in this next council meeting, more than happy to put that as a resolution.
Think it expired in 2022 or something.
Oh, expired. So automatically
Yeah.
expired. But I thought they extended it. I thought for sure. Okay, so we're good.
And the
So
only reason I bring that up is because transit bases they're bringing services back to the zone 3 and 4 coming back to normal. Like the last time I had a conversation with them, until zones 3 and 4 were back to normal permitting and everything, they were not wanting to extend their
permits. Zone 3 and 4 are back to
normal. Okay, good.
Yeah.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Yeah. So this, I'm just presenting to you what the actual cost is to break even ish mostly. You know, again, we can't be entirely certain. And the reason that we've included the none of our residences are being metered right now, right? Our businesses are, most of them, but none of our residences are. But we've included that residential metering scheme to sort of identify for you what the costs might look like for that. So each home would have a $50 a month base rate, which pays for, you know, meter replacements and things like that, meter repairs. And so builds our revenue for that, because these meters obviously age out. We have to put in all of our technology system to do the automatic readings and things like that. And then there would be a consumption rate. And typically, if your consumption is normal, it's relatively small extra over that 50. You probably won't get any higher than we currently are. It's people who are using excessive amounts of water that will see an increase in the rates.
So an automatic 600 a month just to have your meter.
Yeah.
And then it goes on consumption.
Yeah. And that will get us to an operating break even with the potential to have some, depending on consumption levels, to have some monies go into reserves for upgrading of our aged infrastructure that we cannot currently fund.
For new builds and renovation, are you for residences?
So we're bringing you probably in January. We're just reviewing the water and sewer bylaws right now to make sure all the appropriate language is in there so that we can, right now, new builds do.
Yeah, I think my son had.
Yeah, new builds have to for residential and non-residential, and all non-residential existing have to have meters. We don't have any language that requires current existing to have meters. So we need that to change so that we can bring in the metering program. So right now, all new has to, with the last amendment that we did, all new has to provide or put in a meter. I'd have to check if we have any in stock, but yes, probably. We do usually have some around. So if you're doing a renovation, well, and with the metering program, part of the funding is for us to pay for those meters to go in. Right? It's not meant to be a burden to the tax base. It's for us to try and get those meters in at as zero to very low cost for residents.
So with these utility proposed charges, like, what will this look like for the average citizen? Because when you see single family home at $250 and single family with a suite at $437, and then you've got sewer at $200 and then $350 for a suite, how much is garbage? Like, what are people?
Garbage hasn't changed.
Garbage is $329.80 annual.
Annual.
Yeah. Annual. So it comes to $1,229.80 for the year for water, sewer, garbage.
Mm-hmm.
When last year it was $975.36.
So, and then with the suite, how much is that going to be?
Again, it's significantly it's more because we're trying to put the burden where burden belongs, right?
Yeah, that's huge.
So let's understand one thing about somebody who's got a suite. They're making rent money.
Well,
it's not like
everybody.
They're giving it away. So I've got no problems with somebody with a suite paying a little bit more because they're charging rent.
But this is like 65% more. I don't know. Which list are you looking at? What page? I don't know. I
this one?
I think it's excessive.
This one, yeah.
So
not everybody's getting
watered ones. You'll see like the single family with mm-hmm. secondary suite. This has gone up significantly, and same thing on the sewer side.
Okay, so there we don't have this year's on here.
No, we don't. Sorry.
So I guess the question comes down to the fact.
We can bring up this year's is right here. So 2024 on this one is what we charged for 2024.
So I guess it comes down to the fact whether we want to do this over a certain period of time or we want to do it all at once and bite the bullet, I guess. That's what it comes down to.
Well, I don't like having to have this big lump.
But you see, here's the thing.
I think it's necessary.
Here's the thing that gets me. The first year that we sat in budget, We were told that our sewer and water was so full of money that we didn't have to do anything and we could actually breathe easy. And we were told that many, many, many times through budget, right? And that obviously was incorrect because...
Our first year budget, or are you talking
our
about
first,
last year?
Our first year budget.
It was a very big budget.
Our first year budget. We were told that water and sewer were very plentiful and we did not need to touch them, that they were able to stand on their own. And that was sold to us many, many, many times.
But I think, I can't remember which one, but one of them only has $500,000 in reserve, which is less than a block of work.
And I think, you know, with what we had last year as a raise and the way we explained it to the people of the city is that, yeah, this is a hard pill, but we're trying to get back on our feet. And this is not an easy task. And, you know, I really commend this council for sticking your head over that line because, yeah, it's tough. It's not easy. And but, you know, we've got to, what we're trying to do here is not only make the city better, make it safer, bring things here, but we're actually trying to get our finances back in some sort of order. And, you know, all those years of, and nothing against the financial people that were involved in it, but now that we've got a professional, we can see where all where we hit the failing were. And I mean, I know the 25% is tough, but I mean, by taking it over a number of years, then we added more taxes somewhere else. I think at this point, we're going on the best decision on these on professionals that do this for a living to get us to a point where next year we talk maybe 4 or 5%.
I totally agree with that.
I
don't like it, but I think we have to do it.
The thing people have to remember, we have to pay taxes too. It's happening to us as well.
And they also have to remember, Dana, I can remember I wouldn't even open up that bill for years and I knew exactly what it was going to be because that water sewer garbage bill never changed for 10 years or more. I mean, it just, you knew what it was. So I don't like it, but I think we have to do it.
The thing that I have issue with is the large increase just for just in 1 year is the shock and the amount. Because sometimes the same house, maybe they put the legal suite in because it was to accommodate whatever. Or you bought the property and have the suite, whatever the case may be. And that's just the sticker shock. Because if you're thinking of taking, say, utilities with a suite from about $750 to $1,200 in 1 year, that's over
it is
50,
a lot.
That's 50%.
Yeah, it is a lot. And I don't think it's unreasonable for council to say we should do it over 2 years.
Yeah.
The way that Kevin has the budget currently aligned is that these rates and fees, he has taken the 2025 rates and fees from here, from the old bylaw, because we haven't approved those, right? So he's taken the old and he's balanced the budget on those rates and fees. So if council chooses to go with a smaller increase this year and a bigger increase in 2026 to equal, right? Because I'm only proposing 5% in 2026. If you want to spread it over 2 years, it's okay. It doesn't necessarily have as big of an impact.
But you have
on
to
our
take money
budget
from somewhere else.
Well, yes, but we've balanced the budget without doing these increases, right? That's the taxation that we're going to present to you is without these increases. So these increases will basically be an opportunity for us to put some, hopefully, fingers crossed, some surplus in the bank. Knowing that we need to get to this to be balanced, right? And so if you do it over 2 years, instead of balancing in 1 year, you're going to balance in two. Given that, like you said, you had 10 years where nothing changed, it's not unreasonable for council to consider balancing it over
so
two.
You could do 12.5, 12.5?
I mean, we could have to do some math. It won't be 12.5, 12.5, because there'll also be a 5%
for next
inflationary year increase, right? So Kevin will do math.
I'd rather do it evenly over 2 years.
Okay.
That's my thought.
As long as we don't, because you mentioned either if we don't do the big increase, you'd have to take, and I said Rob and Peter to pay Paul, you had to take money from somewhere else.
Well, normally, yes, but because Kevin balanced or is presenting you a budget that does not include these increases, the taxation level that he's recommending is based on what we had proposed in the last bylaw. So this is actually going to be a bonus if you approve this. This will get us to be, by the end of 2026, not having to worry about the water sewer fund.
Well, then it would be a lot more palatable to the general public if we went 12.5 and 12.5.
Yeah, spreading it out.
Yeah, so I'll talk. We'll look at it and we'll figure it out before we have to bring this to you
okay
next week.
Great.
So Okay, next question, Councillor Charney.
Huh?
I think you had more questions?
No. Oh, not on that.
I have a question for you or something.
Sure.
I'd like to everybody to turn to page 40 of 97.
Which I don't have pages.
I'm anyways, that is the Schedule J to bylaw. That's the park and field and charges schedule.
Okay. Well, yeah, I got a question mark.
So okay. What's nice about that is the users who actually came up with that, the user group. And they, it was probably one of the best things that we've done was have the users actually form a committee to talk about tax raises because they got a very quick lesson on how everything goes. And this was completely their idea on these charges. And what I really like is the fact that what we found out through this whole thing is that we have out-of-town people that come to use our facilities because we're cheaper than doing it in their own communities. So now we have a 25% out-of-town user charge. So I'm very happy with the committee that they buckled down, they did their hard work, they made the tough decisions, and they're very happy with that.
So what was it before? Let's just take the adult weekday field use charge.
Well, it wasn't what it was before. It was what we tried to propose last year that caused the issues.
Yeah, it was $100.
So what it was before was like $180 or $200 for an hour for the whole season. Right?
Okay.
It was like, so an adult league, if they booked an hour from 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock on Mondays, every Monday was booked. And the whole total cost was about $200.
Oh, I see. For the whole season.
For the whole season.
Okay.
Right. And so now what we're trying to get to do is what was happening then is that people were booking fields and not using them. So the general public couldn't use them. And we weren't really collecting any money anyways. Like it was kind of sad. And then we were not charging youth at all. The idea is that there is a significant cost. I think we showed you guys the graph that Kevin did.
How did these rates actually work?
Yeah.
Where it says adult weekday field use charge.
So per block, per field, per
hour.
Use.
So $5.60, right? For the fee, per, when you say per block, like
per hour on the field.
Okay.
Yeah, per field. Per
each
hour.
Person. There's a whole term. Oh, per person?
No, no, not,
no,
per,
no,
person.
Not per person.
Per hour.
Per hour.
Per hour, yes.
Correct.
Per so hour per field.
Mm-hmm. So if they're there for 3 hours for
it's 3 hours,
$17. They pay that, and they pay $20 a week or whatever.
Yeah.
Instead of 180.
But we're going off with it because we drastically jumped everything up, and one of the things that we found out working with this group is the fact that Kamloops is actually their ball situation has died because they've raised the prices so high.
Oh.
No one's using the fields, so there was a really dose of reality here, and I'm really proud of that group that they worked as hard as they did. And we'll continue to meet. They're not done. Mm-hmm. We'll meet 4 times a year to go over these things. And I think ultimately, as the CIO has alluded to, is the fact that what we're trying to do here is that at some point in time, the youth never have to pay to do sports in the community. We're not there, but hopefully one day that's the dream sort of thing, right? So,
well, will we pay the cost of maintaining the field with
of
this?
Of course.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep. So currently, you know, idea with recreation and arts and those sorts of things is that you're never going to cost recover like we want to with water and sewer or garbage collection, right? There's no cost recovery, but you want to hit a percentage that council wants the cost recover. Right now we're at about 16% with the inclusion of this, these amounts. We're at about 16% cost recovery. Some communities, Kamloops, for instance, is trying to get 50% cost recovery. That's probably why their diamonds are now so high. Industry standard kind of tells us maybe around 30% would be ideal for recreation services. But we're only, overall, all of our recreation services, we're only cost recovering 16%.
16%?
16%. The rest of it, the 84% is covered by your taxes.
Well, between transit and
yeah.
Yeah, and that's
all of our non-core services, right?
And that's why it was nice to have this group, because when you don't see how the inner workings work, and then you get to see it, like they want a new ball diamond, they want a changing room for umpires, they want a fourth field. Sure, they want lights, you betcha, but how do we pay for it? How do we maintain it? You can't just, you
yep.
know. So I'm proud of that group and the work that they did. They did a lot of hard work. And they'll continue to do that work.
So in the community services section, there's not a whole lot of change.
No.
I know council's concerned about, and we're now out of order. Do you want to stay in this section or do you want to go back to closer
Sorry.
To the beginning? of the bylaw.
Community services?
Yeah, community services is your recreation and
yeah. So where center. Did you want to go back to?
Well, this is like
the summary that you wanted to go to oh. first.
Yeah, like this is partway through the bylaw. So if you want to go back to sort of the beginning of
your preamble.
Yes. Yeah, your my briefing note.
Yeah. Okay, so I'll give all the little housekeeping to Linda.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. On cemetery fees, burials outside normal work hours. How often does that happen?
Often.
Really?
Yeah.
Weekends.
And it's overtime and it requires a minimum of two people. But yes, often.
When you have a Saturday funeral, you're charging?
Yeah.
Can you just leave the dirt until Monday?
No.
You think the marmots are... At least leave the coffin there and then bury it on Monday. There you go.
It is like...
I think people are mad about the marmots now.
Imagine
if we did that.
Okay, and then on page 19...
Under which section, sorry?
Under bylaw fees.
Yeah.
Page 5 of that section. We're talking about the cleanup of the unsightly, the good neighbor, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And it says when staffed, are focused on this type of work, it means other work is not getting done, but they don't do the cleanup, do they? How often
but
do they do
we
the
have
cleanup?
To do we have to do a we have to do an investigation, we have to write letters, we have to do follow-up, we have to contact the contractor. Sometimes we have legal discussions. Sometimes Linda has to be involved on legal discussions. We have times where we have to involve the police because of violent offenders who are the people we're cleaning up for. So there's actually a significant amount of other work that happens that you don't see in the background to make it possible for us to do these unsightly cleanups. It takes hours and could take hundreds of dollars.
Okay.
And again, it's a special service, right? It's not something that it's something that we should be at least cost recovering, if not more, because the general populace should not be paying for somebody's inability to keep their yard clean.
And I think you mentioned it already, these abandoned vehicles that we can't go back to the owners to get the cost.
We're updating the traffic bylaw to do some work on that as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because that's a large cost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So everything else here is just housekeeping.
Yeah.
I want to go back to the Civic Center, mm-hmm. get some charges. Mm-hmm. I still think the kitchen rate is way too high.
So we have found that we have not lost any revenue or significantly lost a lot of bookings in 2021 at these rates. So if you think about, I mean, the kitchen's high, I don't know. But if you think about, for instance, somebody, if you rented a hall for a wedding, what would you expect to pay? Right?
Square.
Well, most of them are going to be more than $2,000 for the day, which is what we charge-ish, $200,000.
And what you're renting, I guess.
For a wedding?
You can rent the Catholic Church Hall for about $500 a day, and it has a bar and a commercial kitchen. It's smaller, mm-hmm. but I'm just saying as a comparison.
Mm-hmm.
And like even the chambers having their Christmas party out at the Lornicola, because it's quite a bit and I'm just for feedback,
yeah,
no. And I'm not being critical, but I'm just saying that I'm concerned that people, committees, volunteers, everyone is a little nervous on the cost. That's it. That's all.
Yeah.
I love the Civic Center. I think it's great. It's a great building. It's right in town. It's awesome. Can everybody afford it? I don't know. 2024, I don't know exactly what the rates are, but I see that it's $2,000 a day for the whole building.
Yeah, and that's really the only change other than inflation from 2024.
And last year it was what, 15?
So the entire facility was 15, and the director had an issue because the full auditorium was 15. So he, for the commercial and for profit, so he asked me to, for the entire facility, should mean more than the full auditorium. So that's why that went up. Because I made the full facility and the full auditorium the same amount. And one should, definitely the full facility should be more than just the auditorium.
Mm-hmm.
So, but again, we haven't seen a significant change in revenues or bookings, right? The building's still often full.
And if we make this bylaw, for now, like we'd have to keep that for the year. We could revisit that.
Revisit.
I'm just
absolutely.
I mean, what if we find, okay, you know, we are losing events next year because of the rate? Like, I don't know.
We're already seeing tree buckings for next year
at the $2,000 rate or at the
2024 rate.
Okay.
So people are already booking into next year.
Okay.
Yeah.
We haven't lost one day where there isn't anybody in there. Not one. Question I have, can I move just a question? Schedule G bylaw, airport fees and charges.
Mm-hmm.
I see what we've got in here, fine, no problems. But what I would like to do is maybe talk about, we have to have some sort of a rate for firefighting season when we have helicopters up there and what that looks like and whether we're going to comp them their parking fees if they are buying our fuel or what we charge them when they're firefighting. Now, in the past, we have allowed them to park up there for zero as long as they're using our fuel. But there are some helicopters, such as the B-100s, that have to have a high flow pump situation. They pump out of a tanker. That has to happen. So they would have to pay some sort of a rate. The other thing that we have to be careful of is allowing those heavy, heavy tankers onto our pavement when it's hot, because they have done damage in the past.
So with the airport, we are significantly using tax revenue to offset the cost of the airport. Is that the role of the taxpayers, given that the airport is not a core service and it's used by very few people? So what I would say, Mr. Mayor, is that any of those sorts of things we would do on a contractual basis rather than through the rates and fees bylaw.
Okay. No,
yeah.
That's fine.
So we will, and we have to look at those costs, right? Like we basically are losing money in what we were previously charging for fuel, because we're then paying the cost of replacing and repairing the equipment. But we're not charging, and we were only charging enough to offset the purchase that we made for fuel.
But the 25% will negate that.
And then there are 15% capital investment charge for the overall airport.
Okay.
Right? Because right now we can't do any infrastructure work in the airport without significant grant support, because we just don't have, we don't have money for that. It's not a reserve. We basically have
two planes flying. That's it. Two.
So
there's just no money in it. And that's why conversation today, we need to start marketing the properties that we have up there and get
mm-hmm.
somebody up there and get those to pay for themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But the thing is that when we do have firefighting season, we have to have a different rate on how that looks.
Yeah, absolutely. And so we'll do that on a contract basis with the province, wildfire services. Because we also don't want to be billing. If wildfire services is bringing in service providers, we don't want to have to bill those individual service providers. We want the government to pay for it, because we know they'll make their payments. Those other service providers, we don't want to be chasing. We don't want to be chasing service providers that are being hired by another agency. We want to pay the agent. We want to bill the agency that's providing the service, right? Like, we don't want to be playing third party chasings.
Mm-hmm.
So,
why is this whole terminal building rental scratched out?
Because we're using it as the EOC.
Thank you.
And so we don't use it for rentals anymore.
On the Schedule M, the animals, when you're disposing of an animal or veterinary fees, are these animals that have been seized?
They would be animals potentially that we have gone through the process to have them.
And so who's going to be paying that bill if they've been seized?
Well, so when they get seized, there's still the... there's still a bill for having them in the shell, in the pound, right? So there are still impoundment fees when we seize an animal. So that's, you'll see these are significantly higher than the previous fees, Because what we're finding is, and what I think is really important part again, is this is one person's problem, right? It's that person with doesn't keep their dog confined, or they have an aggressive dog or a dangerous dog, and our bylaw officers are dealing with them and taking them. We spend hundreds of dollars on thousands of dollars on animal control issues every year because of the legal processes, contracts that we have to enter into, investigations on bites. Our pound is falling apart. And we have a pound because some people are not responsible dog owners. So should all of us as taxpayers pay for that, or should the people who are not responsible dog owners pay for it? And so you'll see the fees have gone up significantly from last year because we are having to do more training. We need more equipment. We have way more legal costs than one would expect. The director's spending time, bylaws spending time, I'm spending time. It's really expensive. And we want to deter people, right? Like, you make better choices.
So it's gone up to $75 for a tag.
An intact dog license.
What is an intact dog license?
Not fixed.
Oh, intact.
Yes.
I get it. I always thought you were talking about the tag, and I'm going,
yeah. Yeah.
All right.
No, I think that anything to do with these dogs, it's to do with the owners, and they should pay for it, not the general taxpayers.
Yeah.
We also have to talk about damage. We did have some people that will break in, and
we did have a dog removed from the
pound. So they'll bust the dog pound to get their dog out. So mm-hmm. that's happened. So then we got to fix that, right?
Mm-hmm. There's actually a dog in front of our place all day today.
I wonder who owns it.
Yeah.
No, it's like a blue heeler dog. Really nice looking dog.
Yeah, and I know Wes was dealing with some dogs that were lunging at people today. Like, off, they were loose and they were chasing after some people.
Two-way pit bulls.
So, yeah. So, it's it is a high-risk role that Wes plays, right?
How do we know which dog is an aggressive dog?
We designate them that.
Okay.
So we have standards by which we can designate that. So if it's a dog that is, has not bit anybody, but is lunging, chasing, snarling, we might consider that an aggressive dog. When you've bit somebody, then you become a dangerous dog.
There's nothing under dangerous dog.
It's $1,000.
$1,000 to license your dangerous dog.
Okay. Oh, I see. On the first impoundment. Okay.
No. So, like, at the top, animal control dog licenses, it's $1,000 to license.
Oh, okay. Up there.
And then when we put them in the pound, it goes up. Because why should we have to deal with them?
I agree. I just wondered, does anybody pay?
We've had some, not at these rates, but at last year's rates, we've had some interesting, we've had some dog. We had a dog that I think it was over, almost $3,000 that they paid to get that dog back.
Well, ultimately, the dog ends up leaving town with the person.
Yeah, well, that's fine. We don't need that. I got no issues with any of that.
Yeah, so I really tried to focus increases on places where it is individual responsibility versus community responsibility, right? Like dog pound, cleanups. I think, Council Olgan said, how can we generate other revenues? Well, we can make people who are responsible for causing work to pay for the work that they're causing.
Mm-hmm. That should be common knowledge.
Mm-hmm. So with the change of spreading out the water and sewer increases over 2 years, does the council feel content to bring this to the council meeting next week for first and second reading?
I do. I still think that the water and sewer for the suite is higher at 75% versus a single family versus a suite, I think is higher. That there's a lot of people, the same house can be the same house. It's just now you have a suite, so you're paying, like, it's the same number of bedrooms. So I feel that proportionally it's high. I don't like it. So I won't support it. But we need to vote to bring it to the group. But that's just my 2 cents.
Well, I think you can bring that up when we go to council.
Oh, yeah. And we'll have a,
yeah.
Because like you have the same sewer pipe as other homes and stuff like that. Now, these new houses that have multiple suites, I can appreciate that. But sometimes there's houses that have been built, like I can think of even a home on my street that's the same as any other house, but it happened to have been built 50 years ago with a suite in it that's not rented. I'm thinking, and I know
But
it's not.
you can ask to not, if you decommission the suite, or you come in and you speak to our staff and prove that the suite is not being rented, you don't have to pay for the suite water and sewer. You just pay for the base water and sewer. But the responsibility is on the owner. So if the owner before you had it rented and was being double charged, so being charged for both the main residence and the suites, and you purchase a property, it is your responsibility to make sure that your fees for your user fees are correct. So if you're not using the suite and you come in and sign the declaration or decommission the suite, we no longer charge you for that. But it's your responsibility as the homeowner to make sure that your services meet your needs.
But would the suite have to be decommissioned for that to happen?
Yes. Yeah.
Right now we're actually doing a declaration
Okay.
because we don't want people necessarily to completely decommission the suites, because we're hoping to have a program for people to upgrade suites to legalize them, right? So it depends on what your plan is. If you want to legalize your suite and it's not currently rented, we're asking you to sign a declaration to say that you will not rent it for, and that if you do rent it, you will come in and change your water billing. But
Yeah.
as soon as you own a house with a suite and you don't want to use that suite, it is your responsibility. It's like, saying I got a car that has this feature. I don't want that feature. I want to have a lesser car when I buy it, so I'm going to do that. There's some responsibility on the individual to let us know what services they actually need.
Okay.
I don't know
So
if that's a good
sometimes
analogy.
I can I'm not a water meter fan, but I can sure see where the water meters help, because you could have a house that has 10 people in it, 5 bathrooms, and there's no suite, but it's how many bedrooms,
yeah.
and it's using more water than, the average. So yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And that's why the
That's why
water
water
meters.
meters are the answer.
Yeah.
But we're going to be federally legislated at some point.
Or you could have a house that is large with a suite that isn't using a lot, but maybe they have a pool and they're using a lot of water. It could be anything. It could be anything.
And so the way we're charging right now doesn't equitably, there's no equity in how we bill. Everybody gets billed the same. You could use, 3 times as much water as your neighbor, you don't pay more. You pay exactly the same. So the burden is the burden spread out, but it's not, so it's an equal burden, but it's not an equitable burden.
Well, I think we're gonna have to
So I'll, and maybe Councillor Etchart, I'll bring a couple of other options around percentages, but you might have to then, for some of those, you might have to actually do some more increases, right? To close the $700,000 gap,
yeah.
these are kind of the amounts. If you want to, you might have to say, okay, we're going to do, 15, 15, 10 in order to close the gap, versus 15, 15 with the amounts that I've provided to you.
Yeah. Well, we're going to bring it to council for consideration, likely anyway. So, and then we'll hash it out there. I
Do
guess
you
we'll.
have some figures for us of how close we'll get with the 25% for next year, and then, or if we did it 12.5 and 12.5, is can do that?
Kevin made me a very nice Excel spreadsheet that
Okay.
will allow me to provide that information to you.
Okay. That would be interesting to see that.
Okay.
Yeah.
I like it when Kevin makes me spreadsheets. Right.
So do we have a vote then? Are we finished? Bring it to council for consideration. So we just motion. All in favor? Okay, so carried. And then, okay, so now 4.3 subdivision and development servicing bylaw.
So Pranesh is on if you need any questions answered, but ultimately this is kind of a technical bylaw.
I was just wondering if the every 10 years, is that too long? Is there a need to have it, or is it expensive to change it?
It's not, I mean, we want to have, we may actually want to do all of our planning and development stuff at the same time as our, we're required to do our OCP and zoning. But, you know, at most, this is a 10-year review.
Okay.
Yeah. It should never go long, which, again, many of our bylaws went way past 10 years, but they should never be more than 10 years old. Ultimately, they should be probably never more than 5 years old, but 10 years would be your max.
So I've got a question. I think I'm on. Pranesh, just a quick question. The earth, does the earthworks bylaw fall under this?
No, earthworks, Mr. Mayor, earthwork is a separate bylaw.
Okay,
this bylaw is basically for subdivision applications, so it will cover subdivisions only.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So,
thank you.
One question I had was when people were doing the subdivisions and it said on the first 500,000 and then, so, you know, mm-hmm. different increments, you had 3%. So would they have to put up a bond amount with the city, or would that be permit fee? Like, how would that work?
Yes, there are different different bonds that have to go up to guarantee work.
Okay.
I think we did it a little bit of a different way this year with the Lindley Creek Road subdivision. How we took securities was mm-hmm. a little bit different this mm-hmm. year. We tried something new, and I think it was quite successful. Pranesh, I think we got what we needed out of it.
Yes.
It was less of a burden on the developer.
Yeah, letter of intent or
it was,
security bond. Or security.
A surety bond or something.
Or
yeah.
Security or something.
Yeah,
or
so it was
letter
less,
of credit, maybe? Was
no, it was a surety bond.
It was a surety bond. And it was less yeah. it was less of a financial burden on the,
yeah.
the developer. And it's being used in other municipalities to great success.
We've used it here with the treatment plant back in 2016 when there was a failure.
Yeah. So what you're not seeing as part of this bylaw is the actual servicing standards, which means you must put in this pipe, you must do this thing. And those are not going to be part of the bylaw. Those will be working documents that our team will have and that will be available to every developer who needs to do that work.
But wouldn't that be part of the development permit?
It goes in with your packages, right?
Okay.
Like it doesn't have to be part of the bylaw
yeah.
because what we're trying to do a little bit with some of our bylaws is take out schedules that are things that we might modify sooner than the bylaw gets modified, right? We don't want to be amending bylaws because we want to change a form.
Yeah. Yes, if we don't have too many questions, I mean, it seems is the 20 meter length of road, is that the standard right now, or is it smaller than that? Because right now we're talking about
The stand road width standards are pretty much the same as the current bylaw. It's just go ahead.
So the 20 meters plus the 5 meters for the cycling and walking.
Yes, path. for the sustainable transportation infrastructure.
Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, because I was kind of going through it and I didn't see anything too crazy, other than I was concerned about how much that the developers are going to have to put down if they want to do their project. Like, there's just so many details.
There are
the whole meeting.
It's not inexpensive work to be doing this kind of development.
So I thought we better ask.
Do I hear
but
a
anyway,
baby in the background?
I hear one.
Well, yes.
We've been waiting. Been there patiently, but I mean, it seems pretty normal. I mean,
yeah, it's pretty typical. And Pranesh worked very closely with a consultant from another municipality, a planner from another municipality, to kind of look at what the standards are across other municipalities to make sure we're in line, which we are.
Okay, well, as far as I'm concerned, it all seems fairly straightforward, except for the fact that we're still doing it by hand, are we not?
We're still waiting for the I'm not, I'll have to follow up with Rick. We were going to start with building permits, e-permits, but I don't think, Pranesh, that we've seen much work out of the contractor.
Yes, there was some technical glitch. He wanted to have GIS rest points, and our consultants, our contractor Catalyst, they don't have it. So recently, I think Tristan has provided those GIS rest points from TNRD. So now it's moving forward.
Yeah. Okay. So we have our GIS didn't align with their software. So TNRD is using
What's
a different
GIS.
Geo something spatial.
Geographical Information System.
Yes. geotechnical
geotechnical
information.
information
Yeah.
system.
So we have TNRDs doing a GIS project with that we're bought. We've purchased part of their work, and so now we can align our those systems. So we should see some movement on building permits, and if that if we can integrate that well, then we will move on to other types of permitting online. Yeah.
Well,
motion to move it to council.
I'll second.
So we need a first and second, or so it has to be either.
Okay, I'll move it. Let's take it to council.
Okay, carried. Okay, so now we're down to the good neighbor bylaw.
Thanks, Pranesh.
Thank you, Pranesh.
Yes, thank you, Pranesh.
Thank you, Pranesh's baby.
Thank you so much.
So with the good neighbor bylaw, our last discussion on the good neighbor bylaw, I had included some fees for vacant lands. It didn't seem like you as a committee had an appetite for that. I took that out, and that's where some of the additional fees in the rates and fees bylaw come from, is to deal with those people who are not, like I'll tell you, we have a house that was had fire damage, and the owner, who does not live in the community, called the fire chief and asked them to go board it back up again. Right? So now we're going to say, oh, sure, but here's the cost.
Yeah.
Right? Like, so, you know, that's really ultimately what we're trying to do is recover some of those costs from people who are using us as a security service.
So my only concern that I have here, like, I was trying to actually find, like, the situation with the vehicle, more than two unlicensed motor vehicles, except for property is owned for storage. It seems reasonable. But when you say unlicensed motor vehicle, if one is, say, a motorhome, and one is their convertible car, and what, you know, it, do we have a limitation for one for vehicles like cars and trucks and one for RVs? Or
I mean, I guess it depends on how many things council feels is reasonable to be parked on a property.
The reason
when
why
does it become unsightly?
Okay.
Or storage.
But if a person just happens to have, because some people have a motorhome, they have a camper, they have their
four-wheeler,
you know, whatever, their pickup truck that they use for fishing in the summer. Like, I know it's maybe not to people from different areas, or if you live in the city where maybe you only have one car in a whole family, but in people here tend to have more than one vehicle. So, and they put storage on them in the winter and they don't drive them.
So there's,
but derelict is different than regular vehicle. If a vehicle can be run under its own power, I would say, okay, well, that's just your, you know, it's just part for winter.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I would differentiate.
Yes. But you've got situations like, there's a spot in town where a person has one 18-wheeler, then they have two, then they have three, then they have four. They all look great. They're parked nicely, but he's got four 18-wheelers plus all of his stuff. At what point do the neighbors say, you know what, this is more than what we're willing to stand
for? This is a residential area,
yeah.
not a commercial.
Or they
so what if, I'll go back to the house that's got 10 people in it, six cars. So now how do we handle, if they're all registered.
Mm-hmm. If they have insurance on them, that's not unlicensed.
Yeah.
I guess that's the
idea. Yeah, it's things like if you drive around anywhere in town right now at this time of year, there's a fifth wheel, a motorhome, an RV, a cargo trailer. You know that those are not all there.
Oh, I know. Yeah.
It's
yeah.
Their sons or their son-in-laws or their daughters.
Storing them.
So again, if they're, I feel, you know, if all of a sudden they are there and the wheels are flat, it's sitting sideways, and, you know, that's when I think we need to start acting.
So what about if they've got their daughters and their sons and their whatchamadoodas, and they're all on storage insurance. They're insured. So does that make a difference?
So there's a difference, and Councillor Etchart can correct me if I'm wrong. So there's a difference between having a vehicle that is registered and a vehicle is insured. A vehicle that's registered for the road has to have insurance, but a vehicle that's insured does not have to have registration. It's not, you can't drive it on the road, right?
Huh.
So we're this is a discussion we had because we also have a number of vehicles that are parked on public lands that are not registered to be on the road. They could have storage insurance, but they're not registered to be on the public road, so they should not be on a public road.
Yeah.
They should not be using public roads for storage or public property for storage.
But if people have a bunch of vehicles at their home and they're insured and they're driving them and using them, that's just
right.
I think, I think you're right. I mean, if 10 people are living in a house and five of them have an operational car,
that can happen.
That's the way it works.
We're looking, so we've got properties where there are we've got a property right now that our bylaw officer is dealing with that has multiple recreational vehicles, so skidoos, ATVs, campers, boats, and then it has vehicles, trucks, cars, multiples. Probably many of them are operable. Some of them might even be insured, but it's the entire backyard is full, right? Is that conducive to a residential neighborhood? And so what are the boundaries? What are you as a council comfortable with? What is the difference between running a storage lot and a residential neighborhood? What is the difference? So if you are a business owner and you have a home occupation business, you are not supposed to be parking your equipment in your yard. So there are businesses, home occupation businesses, where they have, snow removal equipment parked in their yard. Well, that's not part of your business license. You can't park your industrial equipment in your yard if you're in a residential neighborhood, because that's not residential, right? The intent of a residential neighborhood is exactly that, right? We don't want industrial equipment overtaking residential neighborhoods. We don't want storage yards overtaking residential neighborhoods. So it's a matter of you guys, again, much like yesterday's discussion, what is your comfort level? Where do you sit? What do you think is appropriate for our community? What do you think is the tipping point to make our community not appealing to people because it's unkempt?
Well, one thing that we have to be careful of is there's some people that work for some of these construction companies that park their vehicle at night, their work, and they have their work trailer with them, and it's one unit. So I'm not saying that sometimes people take the work van home, and that's how they get to and from work, and
And that's fine. I'm talking
yeah.
about like
Yeah. Long term.
equipment, right? Not a truck. A work truck with that thing on the side. Talking about equipment that sits in people's yards and they use their yard to store their commercial or industrial equipment.
Okay.
Yeah, well, if there are times where people have their equipment with them and the trailer's attached to the vehicle and they
But
take it.
that's the intent is
But
that is needed.
yeah, and
Yeah.
it comes and goes. They go to the work site, they come home, and that's their work vehicle, and they have it. But I mean, multiple pieces, I can understand. I don't, the
I don't think
bylaw is
you're
not
talking
lethal.
about the vehicle. I think you're talking about a piece of equipment.
That's their improved
So
gratuity, maybe. Yeah.
I've got a snow plowing business and I have all of my
Equipment in the yard,
equipment
yeah.
sitting in the yard
Yeah, but
and
you
I'm
work
not
from
using
home.
it. But
I'm in a residential area.
your home occupation does not allow for that. Your home business license does not allow for that, right? You can have your a home occupation business is a desk and computer business. Right. So if you're running a snowplow business out of your home, you can do all of your desk and computer work from your home office, but you can't store your equipment in your yard. That you have to find a place for that. Right. Like that's the difference between a home occupation and a business having a commercial or industrial business in those zones.
Well, I think that to a certain extent, we're still small enough that that's going to happen. And
I think so too.
I don't think we should get too carried away.
Or we should have some kind of permit requirement or something. But I don't know.
It's what
I
you.
understand your point. You don't want it to get out of control. But also at the same time, there's a lot of people that they have their logging truck parked out front and they've been there for 30 years and it hasn't been a problem. But all of a sudden in 2025, it's a problem. And
But
they're
it
going to
has to
think
be
we're
because they
picking
can't
on them.
park in
And that's
park
it.
ends.
And I'm just
No.
saying, like, and that's the thing
With
that
a
I think
permit.
they're going to yell at Mike
Oh.
about because he's the mayor and blah, blah,
Fine.
blah, blah,
He's
blah,
got big
blah. He
shoulders.
yells at
He's
all the
got
time.
big shoulders. He gets yelled at every day.
I mean, look at Chip Hubbard. He parked all his work vehicles at his house
Yeah.
well, they
all the
all
time.
did in the 1970s.
Yeah,
And
but the thing is though, but every morning they're all gone. Somebody is driving, right? So, I mean, there's a couple of people I know that have the micro backhoes, right? They're in a trailer, trailer's parked in their driveway. They get a call and off they go. One of them lives very close to me. I don't find it unsightly at all.
Because it's a, yeah.
It's when you have like, multiple trailers and, pieces of equipment
What
and
do you mean it's scary?
attachments and,
I agree with the idea as long as it's not picking on, aha, you have, like, I don't want it to be where people are going all over town and picking on people willy nilly, aha, garbage
But
over here, and then they're getting a big
we're a
ticket.
blue collar town. We work with
Yeah.
our hands. We work in the dirt. We work, we work, we work. But I think what comes here is the fact that somebody has a motor home that is sitting on rims because it hasn't been moved in 40 years. It's completely rusted out and falling apart. Those are the ones that we
Yeah,
target.
yes. Yeah.
The ones that get used Or, mom and dad have a big lot, and all of a sudden they've got five motorhomes. Where do you draw the line on that? Because now the kids are all parking their stuff there because they can't park it where they are. What time do you draw the line?
Especially
Or,
when where they are is a different community.
yeah, so that's
Being
where
there, done
our
that.
decision. For me, one of the reasons that we don't allow logging trucks parking anymore is because it crushes our sewer system, especially the loaded ones. Now, at one point in time, you could get a permit, and there was a little sticker that went in the window where you were allowed to park empty near your home. I'm not sure if that still exists or not, but at one time you could do that. But the whole idea is to have your vehicles parked in a commercial area. So, because the, logging trucks
It's,
start warming up at 3 o'clock in the morning
I was
every
just going to
morning.
say, it's not like it used to be, though, Mike. I don't see that as much
Yeah,
anymore.
let's
Mind
get
you, I'm
back.
not up that
Down
early. That's for
behind me,
sure.
every once in a while, there'll be somebody with a logging truck. Don't mind. I never complain about that because I know they're working. That means that money is coming into our community. The only time I'll say anything is when they've got a full load on. Now I know they're damaging the structures, right? So I think more and more people have gotten wise to that fact. But
And I think it's really important to remember that not all of our roads are built the same to the same standard, right? We have the collector roads, we have the arterial roads. So some of our roads, our bigger roads, have a thicker base and a higher level of asphalt. Most of our residential roads do not. They have a much thinner level of asphalt. So that asphalt breaks. So that when you're driving on those roads constantly with a heavy load, you're actually damaging our infrastructure. And again, when does that become not fair to the general residential population to have to pay for those repairs, right? So that's why, truck routes are important. Should trucks be going down, and I've seen loaded trucks going down
Main Street.
Douglas, right? Which is barely wide enough because everybody parks on the sides. It's barely wide enough for one car, and there's a school zone. And there's loaded logging trucks going down the road. Is that's not part of our truck route? Is that the approved? We need to make sure that we're putting the right vehicles in the right places to minimize infrastructure damage.
Yeah, because this becomes a tough one, right? Because myself, I have a car, a truck, my toy trailer, and then my utility trailer. So I have two trailers. One I just use maybe twice a year, the other one I use every weekend. But I keep them in order and I keep them parked nicely. My next door neighbor has the same thing. He has four or five different people living in his home, and they all work and they all drive four different cars. I don't say anything because they're working, and their vehicles are in the day, there's nobody, and then at night they're all parked in there. It's just the way it is. But if I had a neighbor who had a derelict motorhome that has not moved in 10 years, I'd be saying something, because, it's an issue. But
So that's really what we're talking about is those ones that are the ones that are
standout.
they're just not meant to be there, right? We're just talking about things that are really just like detracting from the character of the neighborhood.
Would that decision kind of, I don't want to put that on the bylaw officer, but he would be able to distinguish that,
That
would
is
he
his
not?
job.
And that's where then a decision could be made by council that yes, it's just, I know a lot of people who are very outdoorsy in this town. There's a gentleman who lives down from me. He has a trailer with two snowmobiles, and then he has an ATV, and then he has an Airstream, and then he has an off-road vehicle. And I know he uses them all. They're all parked there, plus his everyday vehicle. Again, stored nicely, parked nicely, all insured. I don't have a problem with that. But then I go down the street and then I see another one that has three tractors, the one with a wheel missing and everything all over the place. I
And
got
I
a problem
think,
with that.
you guys have y'all have seen the photos that we brought on about the all the unsightlies that bylaw dealt with this summer and the remedial action requirements that we've been doing. And there's a difference, right? You can see like this impacts everybody versus, okay, there's a lot of vehicles in that driveway, but it doesn't negatively impact anybody. Right. Whereas you can see there's a very difference when we're talking about what negatively impacts our community, what negatively impacts the neighbors and their ability to sell their home. And, I was just looking on, I look at the housing for sale quite regularly just to see what's out there, compare what our trailers are going to be selling for. And I saw a house for sale today and they did like a, a aerial view and the lot beside it is clearly unsightly. I would not even consider purchasing that house because the lot beside it is clearly unsightly. Right? I don't live next to somebody who's going to be like that. So it impacts the decisions people make when we allow places to become unsightly. And that's why this bylaw is super important, because it gives our bylaw team, it gives our administrative team the options to be able to deal with things that are just wrong.
Okay, well, I'll go a step further on that. City rolled in and cleaned up Derry's place.
Yeah.
Back again
And
with
now
more and more stuff. So
that's why
now,
this is
and I
that's
see
why
that
this
you've
is in
got
front of me.
the repeat. But what does that accomplish? A nuisance property designation, and what does that accomplish when you designate there's.
It just means we just keep charging money, and eventually if he has to pay for it through his, it pays for it, it goes on his taxes. He doesn't pay his taxes, it goes to tax sale, right? Like that's our, those are our only options as a municipality. And there was some language in the previous bylaw that did not allow us to address all of the issues, but we've cleaned that up, and we feel like we have the ability now to address all of the issues with some specific places that we haven't been able to really do the work we need to
So,
do.
are you finding that when you've had a contractor go in there and clean up, are you finding that you have to clean it up again?
There are several, yes, and that's why it gets more expensive
Because
as we do it.
I really notice up in the grasslands, they kept that down low this year. So, you know, that was one good thing on that. So I'm
That's what
just,
fines will do.
yeah. Yeah.
And these are not fines, they're fees.
Please.
Fines are something else.
Linda, your microphone was bleeping away there for quite some time. Do you have something to add?
Go ahead.
Just to 2 points that you've brought up. One is in the bylaw, it does speak to for derelict vehicles. So it actually identifies that it's in the case of travel trailers, tent trailers, campers, and tow trailers that is incapable of being towed or hauled in the manner in which a recreational vehicle of that type is normally towed or hauled. So we would be able to make a determination based on that.
Okay.
And or in regards to, there are properties that we have found where we are doing multiple times in a year that we are cutting the grass. Some property owners who may or may not live in town do feel that letting the city come in and cut their grass
Landscapers.
is just a service.
Yeah. So we will make them pay for said service.
Yes.
Okay. Can I go to page 79? Boulevard and laneway maintenance regulations 12.1. Every owner occupier of real property adjacent to a boulevard or lad. I'm not too sure what
Sorry, I
lad
should have
is,
said
but
lane. Yeah.
yes, okay.
Lane. Thank you. Yep.
Okay. Shall maintain all ground covers and plant materials, including but not limited to trees, shrubs, herbs, grasses, and perennials and plant materials planted by the city developer property owner. So I'll take Canford. No, yes, Canford and Main. The new sidewalks went in. Sidewalk, dirt, curb. No water there. So I don't think it's that homeowner's responsibility to maintain that dirt area there. So I don't think the dirt ever should have been put there.
So again, engineers design these things. We go with engineer designs because they're the experts. Many of it was much of it was done before this council was in council or before this administration was, most of the senior team was even here. But the idea is we need people in the vast majority of municipalities across this country, anything between the road and your house is your responsibility to maintain, right? To shovel your sidewalks, to cut the boulevard grass, to make sure weeds aren't growing over the sidewalks, to make sure trees aren't encroaching on sidewalks. It's the homeowner's responsibility.
Oh, I can
Yeah.
agree
And
with those.
so as long as nothing unsightly is happening in that dirt, like as long as there's not like a giant weed growing out into the
There is
sidewalk,
going to be.
but
But
the area that Councillor Charney's talking about, they became giant weed beds.
yeah. Okay,
Like
well,
they
I'll
were
keep it
three
a
feet
dirt.
high. They were giant weed beds. Now, I like the idea of what it was, but I don't think the homeowners are understanding that they could do something with that. If they wanted to put flowers or something in there, they could. I think they think, oh, this is the city's, I can't touch it.
Yeah, we can do some communications about
Now,
that.
if furthermore, if you go down to the secondary school, on the other side where there's that, you know, there's the office and then there's the house and there's that boulevard, that thing is constantly overgrown. Nobody knows who's, it's ours, But the lady or the people that own the house next to it don't feel it's up to them to bring it down. So consequently, we have weeds that are 4 miles high all year long.
Yeah. And so
so
this.
Either, so what I'm getting at is either we get our crew to knock it down or we xeriscape it and be done with it because it just looks horrific.
So this bylaw should clarify that, in that if it's anywhere adjacent to your house, even if it's not the front, it doesn't have to be the front of your house. It could be beside your house. It is your responsibility to manage that. Because if we are going to manage all the boulevards in the city, we're going to need a substantially larger staff.
I understand that. But when we move ahead with a construction situation that leaves that to a homeowner, should the homeowner be asked first if this is the design you want in front of your house? Because now we're asking somebody to now look after 25 to 30 feet of a boulevard that they didn't look after before.
And there's no water.
I'll have to go look at that one.
Yeah, I'll show you them. Because
that's probably
they're
not
really
next
nice.
To that.
They're really nice, but nobody touches them. And last year we had those big wild mustard and they were like balled right up.
Where is this?
Right down,
across
the dog park. Going down
yeah.
the
well, yeah, going down.
So you know where the flood was and all that. So basically, from the turn, and then there's the apartments that Wendy owned. All that has been redone, and it's beautiful. Don't get me wrong. It's just nobody really knows who looks after that stretch, and it looks like a nice planter. It looks like a beautiful planter, but nobody ever knows what to do with it.
So we'll discuss it, because some of this is because we're also seeing homeowners who are encroaching and building structures.
Yes.
That impact drainage, impact sight lines, and they're having no discussions with the city. You can't build structures on the boulevards. You can plant things, but you can't build structures, right? And so we're seeing a lot of encroachment and that sort of thing. So we're really trying to identify, and if there are particular problem areas, we'll look at those and figure out whose responsibility there are. Because quite honestly, there have been a lack of definition of some of this stuff within the organization that we've identified of who, what roles, like whose job is it to cut the lot by Save-On? Nobody's done it for the city, right? And I
what lot by the city?
Our lot.
Yeah, that's a bad area.
So I assigned it last year because apparently it was nobody's job. And I said, well, that's unreasonable. It's going to be somebody's job, right? So those are the kinds of things. If there are particular problem areas, we can have talks about that and figure out what role the city can play in maintaining it versus the homeowner.
So,
but ultimately, we're just saying, think about the fact that a sidewalk is meant to be passable and that we don't want giant weeds between your house and the roadway.
So here's the fly in the ointment. And I'll take you on a drive on this as well. We have some people that don't have a sidewalk in front of their house, but they have their yard and then dirt to the road.
Me. Yeah.
So they go ahead and they fix it all up and they put flowers and grass and everything. And then people picking up their kids from school drive right on top of it and squash the hell out of it. And then they take off and they ruin it. But yet they're told they can't put anything there to stop anybody from parking there. But yet they have to maintain it.
So some of it, and we'll have to look at it, but don't forget the places where it's gravel. That's actually our stormwater management system.
These are going over the gravel on, this is government. This is government down by the school, the one that's really narrow.
Okay.
And of course, now when school gets out, everybody's parked all over the place.
Yes.
So they're parked on people's lawns. And then of course, verbal arguments start. And then the next thing you know, they go after the school. Yeah, to high school.
We have many signage issues that need to be addressed throughout
Hamilton?
The community.
No, behind or Canada?
River Street, sorry.
We
River
have
Street.
People parking in the active transportation River. Paths because they're not properly
behind.
Signed.
Yeah. That's
so we
that's
have
a
many
dangerous
sign
road.
Issues.
Yeah. And all the way down.
So
we gotta decide what kind of what the signs are gonna look like.
When you see the traffic bylaw in the later this year, like in the beginning of 2025, we're gonna be trying to address some of these signage issues and some of these parking issues. I guess I don't know if everybody heard when I said the council begins. We actually have several places where people are parking on the road. Way active transportation path because it's not properly signed. So on it's not Quilshana. What is Home Hardware on?
Cold Water.
Yeah, cold
water.
Yes. Cold
so water. That white line on the side of the road is not for parking. that is actually the
But it doesn't have any bicycle,
yes, it does.
not
It does.
properly sized.
It does have a bike, but it has it at one end and has it at the other end, but
Okay,
nothing in the
yeah.
middle.
Yeah, so those are not parking spaces. Those are active
Might have to put
transportation.
that deco.
Well, so they made the side so wide. It's
Well, it is
ridiculous.
what it is. You're sprucing up a pig's ear, right? So I mean, it is what it is.
Well, if you like it, great.
So how far
Or
does that
I think it's
path go
terrible, but
down?
all the way down to the
Oh.
Oxhall.
Okay, it goes to the
The
Elks
delineators,
Hall, and
the
that and
delineators
that's it.
are there in front of Skooloola.
Yes,
So
So
anywhere
yes.
on
So
that
where do
road, anywhere on that road where you see those white
all
lines, all the way down,
down to
that is active transportation path.
oh,
That's
they
meant,
park there. Okay, then they
yeah,
park there all the time. That is a
exactly.
parking lot.
They do.
Yeah.
So here's an this goes back to the government saying, more density, don't care about parking, so people park on the road. And so where are they going to park if that white
They don't
line?
care. They don't care.
Okay,
This is
but
the
what are we
problem.
going to do about it? So Joe Blow has a house. Two cars are in the driveway, and so he has to park on the road. So we got the white line. Where is he going to park?
Again, these are the failings of a system and a plan that has not been completely thought through. It's
Yeah.
the same thing as asking a single resident to turn it into a sixplex, everybody flushing into a 4-inch pipe. You've obviously not thought about this. So rather than saying, you know what, maybe we should take some time and think about it, we're just going to ram it through and you guys figure it out. And
So
that's not going
maybe
to
we
work
have
for
to
us.
think about this one too. And
Well,
that's again where we
do
have to
we
look at it
have to
all.
have, because it's on both sides
It
of the
is,
road,
yeah.
isn't it?
So I'm
Yes.
so we're going to talk about, and I don't mean to, it was just we have another meeting at 6 and I have to go make sure my children are alive and fed. So we'll be talking a lot about this when we bring traffic, which has been, we have a first draft. We're meeting about it in the next week or so as a team, and we're hoping to bring it to you early in the new year. We'll be talking about a lot of this stuff. So if Good Neighbor seems like it's ready to go to Council of the Whole.
I think it is.
So then we'll call the question then, because
I
there's a lot
have
of
problems.
discussion.
Yep.
I think it'll be fine, but just be prepared for a long meeting that night as well, because
Well, maybe we'll do it over a period of time.
well, it's we could talk all night on
Half
this.
now and half
Okay,
next year.
so let's call the vote then.
Oh, we don't have a
First,
mover and a second, but you
seconder,
cannot vote.
move. Oh, I cannot vote through.
Dana,
I second.
or Councillor
Why
Egan.
don't you just say
All in favor?
Charney and Egan
Okay.
because that's
Okay.
the only
Alternate.
two.
C and E.
Yeah.
Okay.
Union.
ENC.
Yeah. And I think the only other one that
Terry.
we have on the agenda, sir, is the
Medium
studio
surveillance.
surveillance policy. We're going to be increasing our security in all of our sites. We need to have a video surveillance policy to enact that
You need to have a bylaw or a grant
policy.
policy, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it makes sense to me. I read
Me
it.
too. I think it's
Egan,
good.
Charney,
I'll move that.
And me too.
carried.
Okay.
There you go. Okay, and then on that
Easy.
note, since we're at the end, finally, okay, this meeting's adjourned.
Let's order pizza.
Let's do that.
Yeah.
I
Yeah.
ordered 2 million pizzas yesterday for my kids so they could have pizza last night and tonight. Oh.
They're gone
They're gone.
because they were delicious.
Kids.
Does Yakky Joe's deliver?
Stupid Yakky
Could you
Joe's.
walk over here?
Okay, I gotta
Like,
hold out.
I just have to go check on my
I'll go
dog.
get it.
Hey, what kind
Sounds
of pizza do
good.
you guys like?